Mr. Tarrou, this is our sixth video in a series getting ready for some multiple choice questions on the AP calculus exam. We're going to be specifically looking at two examples involving Riemann sums. And if you aren't already following this series of videos, you'll find a link to the playlist in the description. We're going to be looking at, this is the first example involving Riemann sums using a trapezoidal sum. We're given some information and basically a little table here. They like to do this, it seems, with all the review material I've been using with my kids getting ready for the AP calculus exam. We have on a certain day the rate at which coal is being mined is modeled by the function R, where R of T is measured in tons per hour and T is the number of hours since the shift began on this particular workday. Using a trapezoidal sum with four subintervals, what are the approximate tons of coal mined in the first 10 hours on this shift? Now, depending on what your teacher covered in your class, you definitely found rectangular sums using a left and right endpoint. You might have done some midpoint Riemann sums. Here we have a trapezoidal sum, and even if your teacher didn't maybe necessarily cover Riemann sums using a trapezoidal sum and all the formulas that go with it, when you have this information given to you in a table, all is not lost. All you have to do is, maybe just look at the problem and the information and then build a solution based on, maybe a graph of what this data looks like. So let me step off, give this a shot because this is review. I'll come back, reveal the solution, and move on to our second example. So I got the door and I gave a solution. Now you don't necessarily have to do this, but I've taken our data out of the table and displayed it on a graph just to make sure you understand what we're doing here. We've got our time along the x-axis, our tons per hour from function R on the y-axis, and we're estimating the integral between 0 and 10 of R of T dt with four sub-intervals, using our trapezoidal sum. Hey, don't forget, the area of a trapezoid is 1/2 the height times base 1 plus base 2, and now that we have this drawn, we see that the base 1 and base 2, those are those vertical distances, if you will, the parallel sides that whose lengths are determined, of course, by the function. And then we have varying intervals here in our subintervals, but we have our height between each of these trapezoids. So obviously just, here we've got a trapezoid whose height is from 3 to 5, 2, and we have a base of 7 and a base of 8. Of course, we see that in the table. So I am not doing anything fancy, we're just going ahead and 1/2 the height times base 1 plus base 2 for each of the four subintervals and coming up with our approximated value of 70 tons, integrating, get an approximation of the definite integral for R of T between 0 and 10. Now as we move into our next example, we're going to be, again, second example for Riemann sums, we'll be given some information about a function and then determine or list from low to high, what type of values you would get from certain types of Riemann sums. Last example, right now. Now, I was just rereading this before I started revealing the solution, and one thing to note here, where I said in T be the trapezoidal sum, I'm just trying to get this all to fit, that also has to have the same n subintervals. And as you're still maybe trying to think about how to do this, take a note that we've got information about the function, and then whether we're talking about the left Riemann sum, the right Riemann sum, of course the actual value of this definite integral, and then finally our trapezoidal sum with the same n subintervals, that's key there, that for each of these approximations, left, right, trapezoidal, and then, using these to estimate the actual value of this definite integral. I want that actual value in our list of values from low to high. It's very important that we note that each of these Riemann sums has the same and I forgot it for the trapezoidal, but the same number of subintervals. Okay, do you have it? You know what's really cool about this problem? It doesn't matter how many subintervals you have. You can just have one. So, that being said, let's take a sketch here. We have, you know, some kind of function. We're told that our function is positive, so f is always going to be above the x-axis. It's increasing, and it's concave down, so this might be a good visual approximation of what our function f might possibly look like. And you know what? I want to estimate the area between A and B, getting that from, of course, here, with just one subinterval. So here's my subinterval. One. Now we have that actual value. We can estimate that area with a left end point. We can estimate that area with a right end point. We can estimate that area with a trapezoidal sum. Voila. And then, of course, we have the actual value of the definite integral. In this case, we could just say it's the area between the function f and the x-axis between a and b. And we can just look at this graph and now, or this little sketch here, and list our values from low to high. What is going to be the lowest estimate of this actual definite integral? Well, we can see it was the left end points since it was increasing. Then a little bit larger than that, we've got that one subinterval, which is a trapezoid. Certainly the area underneath this trapezoid would be less or more than, the area of this rectangle. And then we have the actual area bound between f and the x-axis between a and b. I can see area because we're guaranteed that function f is positive. Doesn't, of course, we know definite integrals don't have to be just area. But we have the actual, area. And then because that function is increasing, the right endpoint rectangular Riemann sum is going to overestimate that definite integral, and so we have r. And that is the end of this second example. Let's keep going, keep working. We got to get that 5 on the AP exam. Bam! Go do your homework.